Okay, so hello everyone. Good evening, good morning, good afternoon for people in different time zones. So today we are continuing our sessions on machine learning for real world problems with Dr. Sandhu from Chitkara University. So let me pass the word to her to start today's session. So please, Dr. Sandhu, can you start sharing?
So just give me 1 minute, just 1 minute.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Hello and welcome to today's session. Today we will be covering the application areas of machine learning, the most popular and the most prominent application in today's world. So, in the recent innovations, machine learning occupies certain very important domains. Some of them I have discussed here and some we will be covering up in detail. Okay, the very first innovation is traffic prediction. Now, basically, what is traffic prediction? You all must have used Google Maps, right? So what happens when we have to travel from one place to another place? Google Maps provides us the information about the shortest path and the alternate paths also. Plus, if there's traffic jam at a particular location, it will tell you that if the amount of time you require to travel from one place to another is 1 hour, because of that delay or because of that congestion, the time has increased by 15 minutes. Okay. So the very first real world example of machine learning is the traffic prediction, which we are using with the help of Google Maps, right? Then second application we have for search engines. This can be combined with search engines, and you must have heard about the popular recommender systems or the recommendations we get. Suppose you have created your account on Amazon, right? And you are shopping for a particular cloth. Based upon your past experience or based upon your search history or based upon your profile, Amazon will recommend you few items. Okay, that recommendation is based upon machine learning. Because whenever we have the past data, we have the profile and we have the past views, and we know that in the past we have purchased these few items. Okay, so your research or your, you can say your, whatever you want to buy will depend upon your previous history. Then next application we have online fraud detection. So now in case of online fraud detection, what happens basically, you people use your credit card or your debit card numbers online. Okay, so what happens if you are purchasing something? Okay, if the order amount, say my order amount is exceeding 1 lakh rupees, it is a huge amount. So what will happen before pursuing that transaction further, it will be checked that this particular IP, is it a reliable IP? Either we have done those transactions from that IP already or not. Okay, if it is a new IP, then we'll check all the details related to the IP and then let that transaction happen, just to control the number of frauds. Okay. So in this case also, once an IP has been categorized in two categories, either it is a fraud IP or it is a non-fraud IP. Okay, you can use that information to control the amount of online frauds. Right. Now, next application is medical diagnosis. We have discussed this yesterday also. If we have the history of the patient, if we have the past experience of that patient or the past medical problems he used to suffer, we can easily detect this patient is healthy or not. Okay, so machine learning plays a very important role in medical diagnostic in healthcare nowadays, especially in case of COVID. You must have heard people are using deep learning, people are using machine learning to predict whether a person would be suffering from COVID or not. Okay, so in case of healthcare, I think we have the most prominent example nowadays. Then next application is text and speech recognition. Now, in case of text and speech, everybody writes in a different way. The handwriting is different. The way we speak is different. Okay. So what happens? We have that database. We have that previous history. And on the basis of that previous history, we can categorize a particular text or we can categorize a particular speech. Right. Then next is email spam filtering. Now, what is email spam filtering? You people must have got emails in your spam folder. Okay, so what happens? Whatever email comes to you, it is categorized as a spam email or a non-spam email. Okay, if it is not a spam, it will be shown in your inbox. If it is a spam, it will be categorized in a different section of spam. Okay, this is also a type of machine learning. Based upon the previous experiences, the emails are categorized. Right. Then we have image recognition. Okay, in case of image recognition, what happens? We have a database. Okay, we prepare a database. We can identify multiple objects in that database based upon the image. This is a tree, this is a car, this is a person standing, based upon the properties of the object. Okay, so that means in case of machine learning, we also need past experience. We should also have that database for recognizing a particular image. Then we have virtual personal assistants. Okay. A very popular example is Alexa, right? What happens? You simply need to give command to Alexa. Okay, if you are saying Alexa, play this particular song, it will play that song. That is also an example of machine learning, right? Now, automatic translation, what automatic translation means, you are speaking something that is getting translated into a particular language, or you are writing something, Google does this in a very good way. Okay, so Google is using machine learning nowadays for various applications, for multiple applications, right? So these are some of the recent innovations. I'll try to cover up some of the application areas, and then I think we'll start with the basic machine learning models. We'll start the little bit of the implementation. Okay. So now we have an application area of sentiment analysis. Okay, the popular machine learning model we use for sentiment analysis is neural network. Now what happens in case of Twitter? We get so many tweets, right? Based upon certain specific words, like I've written in this example, we are writing the word love, great. Okay, this product is exactly what I have been looking for. So these are positive tweets. Okay, so what a neural network will do, it will self-train itself and it will put the positive tweets in one category and send the negative tweet in another category. So one application area of ML is sentiment analysis, and you will find many research papers also on this area, right? And there are many more areas like social network analysis, sentiment analysis, and we have latest research going on in these areas. And the most popular model used in this case is neural network. You might be remembering we have discussed some of the models yesterday, the names of the models. Okay, so those names I have picked from all these application areas, all the latest models which we have been using, which are the basic model and the latest models, right? So now, what is the benefit of sentiment analysis? Very first benefit is that we have a proper monitoring of the social networks, right? And we get proper customer support. If we are able to categorize the positive tweets and the negative tweets accordingly, our support person can provide backend support. Okay. Moreover, because of competition, because of many social networking apps, the competition has increased. So sentiment analysis is very important to keep those apps in the market. Right. Plus, what we have better tracking of the feedbacks. Okay, how we have the better tracking of feedbacks? Suppose somebody has given a remark. Okay, somebody has tweeted something and people have written their reviews on that. I'll give you one more popular example. Whenever we have to purchase a mobile phone, okay, whether the mobile phone has been launched just one day before, you will get all the reviews of different people. Right, they pre-booked that mobile phone, they put their reviews in that, and following that reviews, you can get better tracking of products or of employees or the brands, you can say, right? So in that way, sentiment analysis is very important. Then next application we have is music genre classification. We have a very popular data set, GTZAN genre collection data set. You can write out the name if you want. Now, this data set contains different type of music. We have pop music, we have rock music, different type of musics, right? And it consists of 1,000 audio files, and every audio file is of 30 seconds, right? And there are total 10 different genres in that: blues, classical, country, pop. There are 10 different genres in that, okay? Now, what happened in case of music genre classification, how the machine learning comes into role is we have different categories. Okay, our music falls in all these 10 categories. What will happen? The different type of music will have different features, right? The pitch will be different, and the MFCC, we call it MEL frequency substral coefficient. Okay. Basically, you can consider it as the frequency. So the frequency for every genre is different. The pitch for every genre is different. So based upon the properties, we train our model. Okay. We have machine learning at the back end based on the data of all these different genres, we train our model. Right. Now, what happens if we add a music, if we upload a new file, right? Our machine learning model has already been trained. Now, based upon the features of the new added audio, okay, it will automatically predict in which genre it falls. Okay, like in this case of, in this diagram, we have an unknown audio. We have uploaded one unknown audio, okay, and it falls in the category of pop music. Right. How this prediction came? This prediction came basically because we have already trained the classifier. See, you can say machine learning model, right? Or you can say machine learning classifier. Both are the same thing. Okay. So based upon this machine learning model, which we have trained, we will categorize the music in one category. Okay, now one more application area we have, this is chatbot. You might have heard about chatbots. Okay, chatbots are basically softwares. Okay, intelligent softwares. What do? We write a query, a chatbot will reply. 24 hours, it is not possible for a person to sit there manually and reply to all the queries. But the queries or the complaint arises whole 24 hours, right? So what we generally do, we prepare this chatbot, we put this program. If your customer support agent is not available, you can get the answer through the chatbot. Okay. Now these chatbots are also divided into three categories. Okay, one is rule-based chatbot, then we have AI chatbot, and then we have live chat. Three options are there. Now, what is rule-based chatbot? Rule-based chatbot basically have a graphical interface and inbuilt questions are there in the chat box. okay? Whenever you'll open the chat box, it will type the message, welcome to this, and you are speaking to this particular chatbot. Okay, so there will be pre-specified set of questions and pre-specified set of answers. Okay, they'll ask you a question, they'll give you 3-4 options, you have to select one option. So that means there is no flexibility, right? They have predefined question, they have predefined answers to that. So when we have predefined things in that, this problem is handled with the help of decision tree efficiently. Okay, we have one question at the root, we have suppose two answers. You select one answer, following that answer, you will have another question. Following that question, you will have another answer. So there will be hierarchical arrangement of question and answers in rule-based chat box. Right. Then the second, we have AI chatbots. What happens in AI chatbot? AI chatbot will automatically learn after an initial training period by a bot developer. Okay. A bot developer will sit there, he will answer the question, and automatically the system or the AI chatbot will learn ki if this question comes, this should be the answer. Right? And the third category, we have live chat. Live chat is like customer support organization. Generally, they have one person sitting there, you have a wait time of few seconds, and you can interact with that person. That is live chat. Okay. So, I'll show you the working also. In case of rule-based chatbot, what happens? See, you'll get the greetings, hello and hi from the chatbot. Then the visitor will select a response. I told you we have predefined questions and we have predefined answers. Okay, you cannot enter things on your own. So, the visitor says, okay, based on the response, what will happen? The very first thing, whenever you are chatting with this chatbot, you have to register your email. You have to write your email over there. Okay. So your email will be captured. If the query is with the sales team and you want to purchase something, so what will happen? Your email will be captured and they'll drop you an email for the meeting. Right. And right at that specified time, either the salesperson will contact you, okay, or anyhow they'll interact with you. It could be mail, it could be a telephonic conversation, right? And okay, in case of support track, which I said, the customer care people, what will happen? The visitor will select the response. Okay, there will be some additional question. The visitor will keep on selecting the response. Maybe in the end, the visitor will have a PDF file or a lookup file for that. You will get the answers. They will tell you, if you have problem with this, kindly explore this particular link. Okay, this is for this first one is email capture and all that is for fixing a meeting, is for talking to the salesperson. And in the second module, we have the support. If we want to tell something or if we want to provide some information to the customer. Okay, now this is AI chatbot. What happens? You input a request and the system will, because it has already been trained, the bot developer will train the system. So according to that training, it will analyze your input and it will understand your request and it will identify the main problem in that. Okay, sometime you are writing, okay, I want a refund for this. So it will pick up those keywords like refund. Okay, it will identify the intent and it will identify the entities. Refund, I want refund for this pen drive. So refund is the intent and what we want refund for, which entity we want the refund for, a pen drive. Okay. And he will compose a reply, optimize the reply and compose a reply, and it will again give it to the user for the next entity. So this is basically AI chatbot. So chatbot, I'll repeat it once more. Chatbot are divided into three categories. It is rule-based chatbot, it is AI-based chatbot, and it is live chat. Okay, rule based chatbot. I'll tell you this rule based system wherever you are using now, whether it is network, whether it is a mechanical system, wherever you are using this word rule based. That means you have set of questions and you have set of predefined rules. Okay, this is how you will perform a particular operation. Rule based means everything is fixed. You will not be able to modify the system. Okay, the rule has already been derived and those rules are fixed and static. Okay, so decision tree is used for a rule based chat box. Right, so far we have seen which two models we have been using, the popular models. The very first was the neural network. The second model is the decision tree. Right. Okay, now coming to the third application. We have the third application as self-driving car, or you can say the autonomous driving cars. Okay, now you must be wondering what actually is working inside these cars to make it driven without a driver. Okay, how the wheel is getting control, how the things are getting controlled. So there are a lot of sensors, actuators and controllers to do that. Okay, and these specialized or AI based softwares are running on ECUs. ECU is electronic control units. Okay. See, in this diagram, we have this car and we have sensors in the front and in the back. Okay. Then we have connectivity, right? These connectivity means when two cars are driving in a row. Fine, one after another. So there should be a particular distance between both the cars. So what the sensors will do, they will basically see the connectivity. They will sense how much distance is required. Okay. Then we have the high accuracy positioning system. Okay. Positioning system means what should be the position of your car, in which lane it should run. Right. And for further optimization, we have the previous history. And in the previous history, we have all those Google Maps. We have all the data. And based upon those data, our machine learning algorithms are trained. Okay, we have to follow this route from a particular source to destination. And we have to turn left and we have to turn right. Right. And that means in case of self-driving cars, what is important? It is important that the environment in which they are running, that should be sensed in a very optimized way with very high level of accuracy. Okay. And if you consider, all these tasks are divided into some of the categories, as you can say, object detection. Right. If a car is moving, it should be able to detect you are overtaking one car, you are walking in, you are moving in this row, and this should be the appropriate distance. So object detection is one thing. Okay. And then we have object identification, or you can say object recognition. Then we have the object classification, object localization, and the prediction of movement. These are some of the subtasks. Okay, object detection means to detect a particular object. Okay, you are moving in one row and all of a sudden there's a tree somewhere in the middle. Okay, so your car should be able to detect that there is a hurdle in between and I should move slightly right or slightly left to pass that hurdle. Okay, object identification means the type of object or recognizing the type of object. It could be a human, it could be a tree. Okay, so based upon the properties, based upon the features, you need to identify or recognize the object. Okay, once you have recognized the object, you need to classify it to which category it belongs. Right, after the classification, then we have object localization. Localization is a very popular problem in all the networks. You might have heard about VANETs, vehicular ad hoc networks also. So there's a very huge problem of object localization. Okay, what should be the particular location? What is the optimum value of that location? On which line we should stay? We should be slightly left or we should be slightly right? Okay. And then last is prediction of the movement. Okay. Now, if we see the machine learning algorithms involved in this, those are, wait a minute, I'll cover this slide also. See, now in this case, what happens? A car is moving, right? A car is moving and this car, okay, if it is a self-driven car, it should be, I told you, object identification. Now see the square boxes. Okay, these, the two cars near to our car has been boxed in square boxes. Okay, this is basically object identification. Localization means in which line, in which path our vehicle should move. Right, and the machine learning algorithms used in this are regression algorithms. Okay, regression means which are based upon continuous values, the pattern recognition. Okay, now there are certain patterns which cannot be recognized. Quite possible that you haven't trained your system with all the patterns. There could be certain patterns which our car will not be able to recognize. Okay, if such thing happens, we automate the process. We already at the back end, a cluster algorithm is also running. If the object is not properly recognized, it can move to, it can pick up some similar object and it could be clustered in that object. Right. So we use clustering over here. We use regression over here. We use pattern recognition. Okay. So these are some of the popular machine learning algorithms used. Some I have discussed in the slides also. One algorithm is SIFT. It is scale invariant feature transform. Now this is a very popular algorithm used in self-driving cars. Now see what happens in this algorithm. We have certain points like 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. We have 5 points here. So what happens? Small little features or small points are stored in the system, right? What we do, we pick up, we have a car, we have a truck, whatever image it is, we pick up certain small areas, we identify certain important points and we store it in the database. Now just imagine, if a car is hiding behind a tree, will you be able to recognize the car? Okay, if that car is partially visible, how will you recognize it? Only if you have partial data, right? So in case of scale invariant feature transform, what happens? We store the partial data. Okay, so this algorithm allows image matching and object recognition for partially visible objects, right? These points are called the key points. These 5 points are called the key points. We pick up few key points, we store them in the database so that if the object is partially visible, still we are able to recognize the object. Right? To increase the precision, we use this algorithm. Right, another algorithm we use is ArrowBoost. Now, what is basically ArrowBoost? This is adaptive boosting. Adaptive boosting means this algorithm is adaptive. What happens? Suppose we have multiple algorithms A, B, C, and D. Right. A is the best algorithm. Right. And in certain cases, C also performs good. So what we people can do, we can mix A and C. Okay, suppose we have in this case, if we look at the diagram, we have these red points. Okay, these are clustered in a good enough pattern. I say okay, these are A points. We'll pick up the A algorithm, the A classifier. Okay, and suppose these are C points. We'll also pick up the C classifier. What we'll do, we'll combine both the classifiers And now we will be able to adapt the performance based upon multiple algorithms. Okay. In SIFT, what we did, we mentioned some of the key points, right? Based upon the key points, we can identify the object even if it is partially visible, right? In ArrayBoost, what we did, we checked with which classifiers are performing in a better way and we combined all the classifiers simply, right? Then next we have TextOnBoost. What is Texton? Textons are clusters of visual data that have same characteristic, right? And respond to filter in the same way. If we apply any filter, they will respond to that filter in a same way. Now, what is TextOnBoost? There's a very, you can say, in a crux, I'll tell you what this TextOnBoost does. You cannot identify everything in case of ArrayBoost. I told you, suppose we are using A, B, and C classifiers. Now, what we did, we picked up the A classifier and we picked up the C classifier and we merged the two classifiers. And there was one more classifier B, right? Maybe it is giving prediction, but it is not giving in the best possible way. But we have left some of the features in B, right? So what happens, not everything is covered in case of ArrayBoost. In case of TextOnBoost, what happens, we will consider information from three sources: appearance, shape, and the context in which it is being used. Okay, sometime merely by seeing the appearance, you cannot tell which type of object it is. I told you, if you are able to categorize the object perfectly, you can use the classification and the regression problem. If perfectly you are not able to classify, if something doesn't have a label, how will you classify it? The only possibility is you can group it in a cluster. Right. Now, an object comes and based upon the appearance, we are not able to label it correctly. So we should have some other sources of information. Na? So basically what TextOnBoost does, this algorithm is based on three main sources of information: the appearance, the shape, and the context. Right, that means to add more preciseness, we are using TextOnBoost. Then we have one more algorithm. It is HOG. It is also again used in these self-driving cars. This is histogram of oriented gradients. Okay. I think somebody, Dr. Deepam, I think somebody has unmuted himself. Please check.
Okay. Dr. Jasminder, actually, I'm not getting who is unmuted. Yeah. I think it's fine now.
Yeah, I see that everybody is muted.
Yeah, you please continue. Yeah. Please continue.
Okay, right. Thank you. Okay. In case of HOG, it is also known as histogram of oriented gradients. What happens? As you can see in the picture, we have an input image. Okay, we have prepared a gradient image, right? And then we have seen the orientation and the normalization. Basically, why it is done, I'll tell you. In case of HOG, what happens, it analyzes a region of image. Okay, you can see these boxes, right? So a particular region is picked from the image, a particular region is extracted, this entire gradient image is divided into boxes, okay? We have particular region of the image and we call that region as a cell. Okay, so it analyzes a region of the image to see how and in what direction the intensity of the image changes. Okay, it works on the intensity of the image. Right, and we can if we are working on the intensity of the image, we can extract all the features, and SVM can also work in classification of this image. Okay, once you have extracted all the features using Hog, you can apply SVM. Right, then we have YOLO. YOLO means you only look once. Now, all these algorithms which I discussed, this Hog, because we have to get the image data, then we have to get the gradient image, and then we have to check the intensity and the orientation and the normalization work. So these all processes are lengthy and these take time. So this is one technique, YOLO, which is very fast. Okay, it also acts as an alternate to Hog. And it is used for classifying objects. It will quickly classify the object. It could be a car, it could be a people, it could be trees. Okay, it is very accurate and very fast. Okay. Now, what is the difference between Hog and YOLO? Basically, what Hog does, it takes an entire image, it divides the image into smaller cells. Right, and it performs all the action on these smaller cells. So obviously that is going to take time, right? In case of YOLO, what happens, this entire image is taken as a whole image. Okay, so it gives prediction in case of whole image. It picks up the whole image, it applies the network evaluation just once, and it comes up with the results. You can see in the very last diagram what has happened. In the very first diagram, we have the picture. In the second diagram, we have boxes, right? We have created the boxes outside the images we need to recognize. And in the third image, automatically it is tagging the image. Okay, this is a dog, right? This is a statue. Whatever is required, it will automatically extract in one go. Okay, so the main algorithm which we use in this self-driven car is YOLO. Why it is used? Because it is very much faster as compared to the rest of the algorithms. But it is not that we can keep just one algorithm, we require all the algorithms. Fine, if you, in case of driving, it is a very crucial context. If I have some features, if I have some data, okay, we learned about semi-supervised learning yesterday. Maybe in some cases, it is not possible to have supervised learning for the entire data. There are some data points we are not able to classify them. Okay, it is neither the regression data, it is nor the classification data. There are certain data points we are not able to classify. So what will we do? The easiest way is unsupervised learning. We'll move to unsupervised learning. Right. So in case of this self-driving car, it is important to have all the algorithms. You cannot rely on a single algorithm. You cannot totally rely on this one algorithm, though this algorithm is the fastest algorithm. Right. So we need all the algorithms. There are multiple algorithms. So far, which algorithms we have discussed, which are more important? Neural network, SVM, decision tree. Right, these are the basic core algorithms which are very important in mostly all the application areas. Now, coming to the next application, our next application is real-time dynamic pricing. Okay, now what happens? Real time means according to the environment. Dynamic pricing means, see, if it is static pricing, you know, going from this source to this particular destination will total incur this much expense, right? But in case of dynamic pricing, what happens? The expense is not fixed. I'll give you an example. Suppose you want to book a flight. Right, or you want to book a local cab. What happens? generally what scenario happens, if it is somewhat different occasion, right? Generally, we have the normal pricing for all the flights. We have the normal pricing for all the cabs. We have the normal pricing. But when it is the peak hours, it could be peak office hours, right? Or it could be the weather condition. Suppose it is raining. So what will happen? You people will see a surge in the prices. You will see that the demand is also high and the prices are also high. Okay, so what is this? Company will fix dynamic prices in this. Okay, and for this dynamic pricing, we have certain condition like weather conditions are there, or it is a special occasion, or it is the peak hours. You will see a surge in the prices, right? And if nobody is booking or where there are very less bookings, the price will be normal. So this is also an example of machine learning. Right, the application, the app you use for booking, it is trained in such a way, okay, when it is the peak hours, it will automatically increase the price. If it is the off time or it is a normal time, you will get the same pricing throughout. Right, so that means dynamic pricing, or you can say the optimum pricing for the business. Right. Now, if we say machine learning will not only help in deciding the price, but it will also help in getting the best price, the discounted price, or the promotional offers. Okay. If you are a regular customer, you will see the promotional offers because of machine learning, because of the entire training. So this is the application of machine learning and real-time dynamic pricing. Then we have social media recommendation. Now, what is social media recommendation? Your machine learning or your AI is being used nowadays for advertising. Right, I told you one example yesterday on Facebook. Right, on Facebook, when you need to tag somebody, you will get the suggestions, and 99.99% those suggestions are correct. That is because of machine learning. Okay, whenever you create a profile on Facebook, your profile information is saved. Okay, your liking and disliking are saved. Your pattern of working with the app is saved. All right. So what happens? According to the past history, you will get the suggestion. You must have seen you get the suggestion for adding new friends also. Okay. Why you get that suggestion? It is based upon the pattern a user searches. Okay. What Facebook does, it takes your personal information. Okay, and it has a machine learning tool, inbuilt machine learning tool, which is FB Learner Flow. Okay, now this also runs on decision tree. It will analyze the behavior of a particular customer, and this also works on decision tree. Okay, so FB, what this algorithm basically does, it make group of people which act similarly. Okay, and also it helps the advertising news agencies to show a particular news which is of interest to the Facebook user. Right. So in case of social media recommendation, also machine learning plays a very important role. See, now we have social media platform. It could be Instagram, it could be Facebook, it could be Twitter, it could be any platform. Okay, we can access this with the help of API. API is application programming interface means you can access it with the help of an app, or you can use a web browser. You have different ways to access it. Okay, so what happens? Now the raw data will be collected. If you have created a profile, the information about a particular user will be collected as a whole. Okay, that is the raw data. And on that raw data, machine learning is applied. Okay, first of all, the raw data is processed. After the processing, after cleaning the data, machine learning is applied. And according to the recommendations given by the machine learning, I told you yesterday one thing. See, here we have three words: machine learning, text analytics, and data mining. Data mining is working with the data. Analytics mean working with the data and giving conclusion. And machine learning, it is basically working on the data, working on the past experiences, and training the model accordingly. Okay, so when analytics word is used, that means the outcome would be some insight, some conclusion. Okay, so in case of social media recommendation, whenever analytics is applied, we come to a particular conclusion. These users are similar. We can club them in one group. All right. Or secondly, what we people can do, we can generate advertisements according to the machine learning model or according to the interest of a particular person. Right. Then we have air quality prediction. Okay, there is one more very popular. You will find the air quality data set on UCI repository also. I'll show you the repository today, and we'll perform a little bit of hands-on on that. Okay, so in case of air quality prediction, what happens? Now, air quality at a particular location will depend on several factors. Okay, it could be traffic. Okay. It could be emission from the railways. Okay, it could be the industrial sources nearby. Okay, and we have the meteorological data also. Okay, we have the wind speed, we have the wind direction. So based upon this data, air quality is predicted. What happens? We collect the entire data. We have to clean the data. That is the very first thing. We'll clean the data. Okay. And then we will derive which features are important for prediction. Once we have selected the features which are important for prediction, we'll give it as input to the machine learning model. Right. And based upon that, we'll get the conclusion or the interpretation or the future prediction. Okay, what will be the air quality in the next upcoming week. Right. The same we can do for the weather condition. There are many, many more data sets available on the repository. You can use them also. So these are some of the applications we have been discussing so far. Okay.
So Dr. Jisminder, can we have a break for 10 minutes?
Sure, sir. We can take a break for 10 minutes. And after 10 minutes, we'll start with implementation, a little bit of implementation part. Okay.
Okay.
Yesterday, I discussed with you that there is a library called Rattle in R. So there are some inbuilt models, and how you will take the data from UCI repository, I'll show you one example today. And properly, we'll start with the coding part from tomorrow onwards. All right.
Okay. Okay, Dr. Smith, there is one question from Anurag Chaudhary.
Yes, sir, please.
That can we predict the share market price also?
Yeah, we can predict.
Oh, very nice. Thank you. So, okay, then, dear participants, let us have a break for 10 minutes. We will again meet at 9:40. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'll pause the recording for
sure,
this time.
Sure,
thank you so much. Yeah. Dr. Ivan, you can start the recording.
Yes. Yeah, I just started it.
Continue with the session.
Yeah, we can continue.
Dr. Deepam, I hope my screen is visible.
Yeah, it is visible. Your browser is coming on screen.
Yeah, Dr. Deepam, just let me know because I'll have to switch between two, three screens now.
Now, okay. Now it's better to share your whole screen then.
I think there's no option of sharing the whole screen. I can select multiple screens and share. So
okay.
Just let
okay.
me know whatever it is.
Okay. Sure.
Okay, now little bit of the implementation part we'll start. Okay, so yesterday I told you two things that in case of R programming, we have one software which is known as R for Windows, right? And the other one is known as R Studio. Okay, we have two things. We have R for Windows and we have R Studio. Okay, I'll show you the screen for both the cases.
Dr. Jisminder, have you given some time to the participants?
Some.
So, now we are getting your R screen.
So we have two interfaces. This is the R for Windows interface. All right. This is R GUI. Okay. And this is in this we have to type the commands line by line and we have to execute it. Okay. This also contains the interface, which I told you yesterday that you have certain inbuilt machine learning tools. You don't need to have the detailed understanding of the coding. Simply what you need to do, you can execute your code in this R window. All right. And the other interface is R Studio. Now, this is where you can write the entire program. It is a complete environment. Dr. Deepam, the screen is visible, R Studio. Dr. Van, this is visible.
Yes, it is visible.
Yes, it's visible.
Thank you. Yeah, it's okay. Easy. Yeah, this is complete R Studio. We have the entire pack, entire environment in this. We can write the code. Okay, the environment variable are saved in the global environment. We can see the plot in a separate window, and we can see the output in the console as well. Okay, so this is an integrated type of environment. But in this, you have to write the entire code, and you can also execute the entire code simultaneously. Okay, obviously R Studio is better. R Studio is used for machine learning, but it does not have any inbuilt facility. You have to write the code for each and every model. I'll show you. See, if you have to run random forest, you have to write the code for random forest. If you have to run decision tree, you have to write the code for decision tree. So separately, you will have to run each and every model. Okay, and you can select the entire code and you can execute the models together. And in case of R for window, what happened? You have to write the code line by line. So how you will install it? Just go to Google and type R setup. The very first setup is your R window setup. Right, you can download it from here and you can install it. Fine. If you are watching this presentation on your laptops, you can do it, or you can simply note down the steps and you can do it till tomorrow. Okay. You can download your R for Windows from this link. Fine. And you can install it. And you can see it is for 32 or 64 bit, and you can simply install it. right? Okay, now the library I discussed with you yesterday. See, we have the library. What we have to type? Library, rattle. Fine. And after this, you have to type rattle. And a window will pop up. You will see the window in a minute. Okay, this is the window now. Now, as you can see, you can import the data over here. Rattle is a GUI for running some of the machine learning models which are inbuilt provided in this. Okay, or it is also used for calculating the statistics on the data, right? And in this case, see, if you want to perform clustering, right, we have k-means, we have some inbuilt models, bi-cluster hierarchical model. These are all the models for clustering the data set. Okay, clustering means, I told you yesterday, clustering means unsupervised learning. Okay, and then I told you a very popular problem of that market basket problem. Okay, that is basically association. See, we have baskets in this. Lift, confidence, support, these are certain parameters which are calculated in association rule analysis. Okay, that is another form of unsupervised learning only. Okay, clustering also you can do here, and you can analyze the associations also in this. Right? And then if we have supervised learning data, if we have labeled features and we have everything, we can use the decision tree model. This is the random forest model. This is the boosting model, SVM, linear neural network survival model. These all are the models to be used in machine learning. Okay, and you can go through the introduction of the models in this. You can select the model, you'll get the introduction over here. Now, this is an interface. You can only execute these models in this. That is the drawback of Rattle. That's why we will be using RStudio from tomorrow onwards, right? And you people can install RStudio as well, right? You can write here RStudio setup and you can install RStudio as well. You'll get the complete IDE. Okay, just choose the version and you can install the free version of RStudio. Right? So please do it by tomorrow. Today we'll be analyzing only this inbuilt models. Okay, now how you need to include the data in these models? Okay, the very first step is to include the data in this model. I'll take an example. I'll pick up a data set from UCI repository and I'll show you how to include the data. Okay. To start with, I'll suggest you can pick up these most popular data set, though these data sets are very old. But you can use this for starting the implementation, right? Yeah, suppose I am picking up this wine data set. You will have a data folder over here. Fine. The data set is saved as wine.data. This is your data set. Okay. And the details of the data set has been saved as wine.names. You will get all the features in this wine.names file. Let me open an Excel sheet. Okay, now wine.name file contains the detail of the dataset. Okay, how it was collected, what was the source, and these are the attributes. Right, so number of attributes, you can say attributes or number of features we have 13 features. All right. Now see, they have provided the description also that all the attributes are continuous and missing values. This is to be checked because not all the machine learning models can handle missing values, right? So this dataset does not contain any missing values. Okay. And now in the target, see the class distribution. What it is saying in the target, we have three classes, class one, class two, and class three. When we have three class, that means it is a multi-class classification problem. Okay, in the first class, we have 59 instances. In the second class, we have 71. And in the third class, we have 48 instances. So this is the entire data set. Okay. Now see, the data set we have downloaded will be in this form. This is the form of data set. Okay, it has been opened in Notepad only. What we will do, we will select the entire data, we will copy the data, and we will directly paste the data in the Excel sheet. Okay, now we have pasted the data in the Excel sheet. What will be the next step? We'll go to data. We will apply text to columns. Okay. Now this, see, this data has been divided with the help of commas. This is 1, 14.23, 1.71. Okay. So what is the delimiter or what is the character separating all the fields? It is comma. Okay. We'll click on next. Now, note, we are not separating the data with the help of tab. We are using comma for that. Just see, you will get the lines and then you can finish it. This is your data. Okay, this is your data. This is your complete data. Right. Now, from this data, you can check which is your target variable. Right, which is your target? Just go through the data. We have in the very first column, we have one, then we have two, then we have three. So that means I told you this is multi-class classification problem and we have three different values in the target. Okay, so that means now let me try to label this data. Okay, I'm taking this data with supervised learning. Let me label this data. The first one is target. Right, undoubtedly, it is a multi-class classification problem. This is the target. And we can label this as F1 feature. We can label the next one as F2. Then we'll have F3. Then we'll have F4, F5. F6, F7, F8, F9, F10, F11, F12, and then we have F30. Okay, so what I have done, I have labeled the data. Right. Now this is my data. Okay, now my next step will be mostly in case of many softwares like you can say this R or this Python, they works well with the CSV file. Okay, now what we need to do is we need to save this data. We'll save it. See, I'm saving it on desktop only. Vine. Sorry. Okay, and we'll be saving it as CSV file. Right. Okay, the description of these features, you can get it from here. See, F1 is alcohol, F2 is malic acid. It is well mentioned in the wine.names file. Right, we always have two files. Wine.names will contain the description of the data and wine.data will contain the actual data. And mostly the data you will download, it will be in this format only. Either it will be separated with commas or semicolons. Mostly we have commas or semicolons. Okay, you simply need to paste the data in your Excel file and you need to perform text to column operation. Right, just perform the go to data and just perform the text to column operation. And when you are performing this operation, just take care of the delimiter. What is the delimiter? Okay, is it a comma, is it tab, or it is semicolon, or it could be a blank space also. Right, just take care of the delimiter and simply click on finish and you will get the data format. Okay, now when you have all the details, when you know these are the 13 features, okay, what you people have to do, you have to select the target and you have to label all these 13 features like this, right? Now, when we'll be working with RStudio, what will be the main formula for prediction? Yesterday, I gave you the syntax. The output, I told you, the output variable will be on, this is output variable on the left hand side, and on the right hand side, we will have input variables. Okay. That means in this case, we have target, we have labeled the output variable as target. Okay. And we have three classes in it, 1, 2, and 3. Okay, what we'll do, we'll write the tile sign and we have feature 1 plus we have feature 2 plus we have feature 3, so on till feature 13. Okay. Now we are not adding the feature. I have told you this yesterday also. We are not adding the feature. What we are telling, we are simply telling that the target is dependent upon these 13 input features. Okay. Predicting the target is completely dependent. Predicting the class of the target 1, 2, or 3 is completely dependent upon all these 13 features. Right. So now basically you have prepared your data set. This is your data set. And now what we are going to do is, this is the like inbuilt interface only. We don't have to, just note down the steps. Okay, do one thing. Just note down the steps. It will be easy for you to write the code in RStudio. What we will have to do, we'll pick up the source. It is a file. Okay. And what is the file name? We have saved it with wine.csv. Right. Now, when you have mentioned the file, simply click on execute. You will get all the features here. And just see one more thing. It has automatically identified because this target has only three unique classes. That means this should be the output variable. And rest are kept as input variable. Okay. One more thing you can do, if you by chance know that for predicting this target, it is okay if I exclude the F8 variable, then you can click on ignore also. You can ignore any variable, any input variable. Right. Now in this case, see, In case of class, we have three unique values. In rest of the features, we have 126, 133. These many unique and different values we have. Fine. Okay, this is the very first step. In the very first step, what we have to do, we have to include the data set and we have to execute it. Now, the second step is to create a partition. Fine. How we'll create a partition? Basically, I told you yesterday, we'll give 70% data for training and we'll give 30% data for testing. All right. This is how we'll create the partition, 70-30. Now, whenever you are working with machine learning, it follows the random approach. Okay, in the end, what we'll do, whenever we run one machine learning model, we run that model for, say, 10 iterations. And we call it K-fold cross-validate. Okay, to validate our results, whenever you will execute your model again and again, the results will vary slightly. Why it will vary? Because when we create this 70-30 partition, it automatically generates a seed value. It could be anything. It could be any seed value. Okay. And randomly, it picks up any data from the file, from the data set. 70-30 partition, whenever we are again and again creating the partition, it will not take 70%, first 70% for training and the rest 30% for testing. No, it will pick up the data in a random way. Any data could come in that 70%, any data could move in that 30%. Okay, it will do this process randomly. For that, we have a seed value. Okay. When we have to run a randomized approach, we always have a seed value and the random values are generated automatically according to the seed value. But this is the central point and according to this, we are randomly picking up the points. Okay. So now we have created a partition of 70-30, 70% in training and 30% in testing. Now we'll execute this. Okay. So there are 178 observations. That means we have total 178 records and we have 13 input variables. The name of the target is target. I have kept it as target only. Okay. And it is categorical. Categorical means it has categories and it is divided into three categories. And see, classification models enabled. It has automatically decided that this is a problem of classification and all the classification models have been enabled. Okay. This interface you can explore a little bit. Okay. We can generate the summary of the data. See. F1 to F13. Features, some are integers, some are double. I'm not audible.
No, not this one, you're audible.
Okay. All right. Please check your connection. See, now in case of summary, this is a summarized view of the data. These features are integer features. They contain double data, okay, decimal data, and target is again an integer. Okay, now see. Yesterday I told you one thing. You can plot your data also. Okay, see. This is the evaluation of your data. For feature one, we'll have the minimum value and we'll have the maximum value. Okay. And the mean of the data is given, plus the median is given, the first quartile and the third quartile is also given. So the statistical analysis will come in summary itself. Okay. And you can explore the rest of the option. You can do that. Fine. I told you box plot. Now, wait a minute. Suppose these are the features and I need to get this box plot.
Dr. Dismindar, I think another window have been opened. You may check, please.
No, it is there in this window only. I'm just checking the plot. We saw it in the morning also. Plots have been generated. It's there. Coming. See. Dr. Deepak, plots are visible. Just have a look.
Yeah, it's visible. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. So, in case of all the features, we can do a box plot. Okay. If we have any points outside this box plot, I told you if the data is not clean and outliers, suppose there is large deviation in your data, okay, and that Dr. Deepam, I'm audible na?
Yes, Dr. Sundar, you're audible.
Okay. Now, if there is an outlier in the data, it will be represented as a point outside this values. Okay. We have a minimum value, we have a maximum value, we have the middle values, and we have all the quartiles. If any point lies outside these values, that is an outlier. Okay. So, simply for visualizing, this is a clean data. The data I've picked, it is a clean data. Okay. The data which will consist of outliers, you will be able to see some decimal points on these lines as well. All right. And this way we have rest of graphs also. You can use histogram. Okay, the rest of the plots you can explore. Right. And they can perform the t-test, f-test on the data, means the evaluation of data you can do, right? See, clustering, I told you, when we have analyzed that, we have labeled the data, okay? And we know the target, and this is a problem of classification. We don't need to check this cluster. We don't need to check the association. We'll directly move to the model. See, decision tree, the fundamentals of decision tree, I'll be picking up that detail. This is simply a black box execution of the models. We have inbuilt model like decision tree. We have random forest. We have SPM. Due to some reason, you cannot execute the boost model in this. And we have linear model. You cannot execute the neural model. Depending upon the data, these models are chosen. In the very first thing, when I uploaded the data and I executed the data, that the classification models are now ready for execution. That means models which fit on this template are automatically highlighted. So if I select all the models and I execute them, right. See, now all the models have been generated and all these models have been executed in 3.0. Okay. Now I need to evaluate the result. Now for result, I thought it is a transmission problem. I can have the error matrix also. Okay, for all these models, again, these models are automatically selected. We need to evaluate the model. So we'll simply click on execute. Right. Now these are the results. Okay. Now which all models have been executed? I'll show you once. Just give me a minute. See, we have executed the decision tree model on this. Okay. In case of decision tree model, the overall error is 9.3%. Okay. And they generally get the confusion matrix and so. Okay. I'll tell you what is that. See. Yesterday we covered up one thing that in case of testing data, we have the actual value and we check whether the predicted value is same as the actual value. Now in this case, when the actual value was 1 and the predicted value turned out to be 1, okay, how many records we had? 42 points. And in case the actual value was 1 and it turned out to be 2. Okay, that means your machine learning model had certain error. The output should have been gave your model gave the output 2 in 1.9. Right? Now, in another case, when the value has to be 1 and your model turned out to give you value 3, there are no successes. 0. Okay, so this is the error matrix. Now, this is for decision tree. In case of decision tree, if I consider overall error is 9.3%. Right. Now we have also executed the random forest model. In case of random forest model, right, again the confusion matrix also has been plotted. You can well understand it. The overall error is 3.8%. Okay, it is 3.8%. In case of SVM, the overall error is 3.7%, and in case of linear model, the error is 9.3%. Okay, so all these models have been executed. Right, this is the built-in interface part, and these things you can do in our studio.
Your voice is breaking actually.
Dr. Deepan, please check it fine.
Yeah, I can also confirm that sometimes it breaks.
Okay. I'm sorry for that. Now it's fine.
Yeah, you please continue, then we will check.
Okay. See, now in this case, we have some inbuilt models. Okay, we can calculate the result in case of the inbuilt model provided in error. These all models we can execute in RStudio as well and many more. We don't have that flexibility to execute all the models in RETL or in this window version of R. Okay, so this is some of the models. See, what I have done is I have picked up the data set from UCI library and the supervised data set. Same you can try with the unsupervised also. You can use the clustering association problem also with that. Okay, so I'll give you an overview how to start this. Simply, you have to open RGUI, you have to keep the RETL and then RETL and brackets, the round brackets. You will get the RETL interface and you can execute these inbuilt models in RETL. You can try this for today, right? We'll start with RStudio tomorrow. Dr. Deepam, Dr. Ivan, I think that's all from my side. I'm open for queries now.
Okay. So I request the participants, you please post your queries in the chat box. If you have any type of query, you please post your queries on the chat box. Dr. Jisminder, there is one question that can we convert image dataset into CSV?
We can work on images. Images can. Am I audible now? My voice is audible.
Yeah, you're audible.
Okay. So, what you can do, you can convert your images. You can extract the features from them, and you can easily convert it to a CSV file.
Yeah, it's fine. Okay. Okay. Mr. Shankar is re-asking that how can we extract features from them?
How can we extract the features from CSV file? Right.
Dr. Jisminder, you told that we can extract the features from image first, right? So he's asking that how can we extract features from image? So I think there is some standard.
Yeah, please continue. No problem.
Yeah, actually, Mr. Shankar, what happens that if we image contains of lot of features like contrast, like homogeneity, like we have different type of image features are involved. So first of all, we need to choose that which type of features we want to consider in for our particular application. So then there are some standard commands which are given in every software platform like R, like Python, like MATLAB. So accordingly, we can use that command and extract the features. And as Dr. Jisminder told you, once you get the features, then we can convert into CSV. I think now it's clear to you. Yeah, there is one more question from Ms. Shweta. Is there any size limitation of data sets in R?
No, there's no size limitation. It is only if your data set size is very much bigger, so it is better to use Python because we have a GPU support in Google Colab. Okay, and if you have installed R on a system which has a very good configuration, you can use it with R also.
Okay, very nice. Thank
okay.
you.
Okay, online we have Google that GPU support in Python. You can go, use that also.
Okay. Dr. Jisminder, there is one more question that some participants is has installed this R in his system. So it is showing library not available. So there is no package called Rattle.
This question is from Anurag Chaudhary. Okay. Anurag, you can do is.
Yeah. I think there is some.
What you can do is. I'm waiting for you.
Actually,
what you can do, Anurag, is.
Okay, please continue.
You can try, if you are having problem in installing the 64-bit, you can try with the 32-bit. Anyone will work on your system. Okay, and there I've seen cases, it is a 64-bit PC and somebody has installed 32-bit, it is working fine. 64 is not working fine. Okay. So what you can do is you can try both the versions, 64-bit as well as 32-bit.
Okay. I think it's clear to Anurag. Mr. Shankar is asking that due to some network issue, he was not able to listen sometime. So, Mr. Shankar, you please don't worry. Dr. Ivan will share the recording of this session also. Thank you.
As per the norms, we'll share the recording or the PPT. We'll do that. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, Dr. Ruchi is also asking that, can you please repeat the last part of the model? So, Dr. Ruchi, once we share the recording of this session, then you will easily get the things that you have missed. I think it will be fine to you.
Last part, which last part wants to be repeated? Which is that last part?
That the application of the model which you have done on your in our software.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can I take 5 more minutes? Dr. Ivan, can I take 5 more minutes?
Yes, yes, sure.
That's fine
sure.
with you?
Yes, yes, that's absolutely fine.
Okay. Thank you. I'll quickly execute the code once more for you. Okay. You just need to pick up your data from the path. Okay. It is wine.cli. You will execute the data and it will automatically adjust. These are the input features and this is the target feature. Okay. And you will get a message printed. There are 178 observations. There are 178 records and 13 input features. And the target is known as target. Okay. And categoric 3 means we have 3 categories in the target. So when we have 3 categories in the target, obviously the classification models are enabled. Those models are activated. Okay. Now how we will take the partition? As I told you, there's a standard 70-30 size. Okay.
Excuse me,
we'll
Dr.
keep
Ms.
the
Leader?
Partition sizes. Yes, sir.
Yeah, your screen is still. Your screen is not visible,
sorry.
Actually.
Huh.
Yeah.
It's fine now.
Your voice is also breaking now. Yeah, it's visible now. Thank you.
Just give me one. So now my voice is audible?
Yeah, it's fine, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay. See, what we'll do, we'll simply, I should start from the very beginning now.
I think you can continue with this part only.
Okay, all right. See, what we'll do, we'll select the partition size. As I told you, the default size is 70-30. We'll take 70% for training and we'll take 30% for testing. We'll pick a random seed value. It could be anything. The seed value is picked up generally just to randomize the process of picking up 70% and 30% records. Okay. Now we will execute this once our partitions has been created. The 70-30 partitions has been created. You can explore the data. Okay. You can get the summary of the data. You can see the plots for the data. You can compute the correlation for the data. Okay. See. If you want to see the summary of the data, just click on summary and execute it. What will happen? This is our data. We have the target and we have all the 13 features. All right. And for all the features, it will show the minimum value, the maximum value, the quantiles, the first quantile, the third quantile, the mean, median. It will show all the statistical summary of the data. Okay. Then next, if you want to create a box plot for the data. Okay, you can do that. You can simply select for which all features you want to create the box plot, and then you can click on the execute button again. You will have the box plot like this. Okay, if some data lie outside this region, those are outliers. Those are generally removed from the data set. This box plot is the best visualization technique to get all the outliers or the noise in the data. Okay, so we have box plot, we can create histogram, cumulative plots, Benford, pairs, you will get the description of all the plots on internet. Okay, right, we can perform t-test, f-test, all the statistical things on the data as well. Now it is well decided. See, you can scale the data. You can also scale the data, that you can normalize the data, that is also there in this. You can clean up the data, fine. And now what our data set is a classification data set. Okay, so the classification models will be executed. We don't need to execute the cluster. We don't need to execute the association rules because these both are unsupervised learning. We just need to execute the supervised learning. We need to execute all the models. Okay, so the models which fit our data are decision tree, random forest, SVM, linear model. Okay, neural network will not work on this data. It is not highlighted. Okay, and the survival model will not work on this data. The boost will not work on this data. Okay, so the highlighted models will work on the data. You simply, if you want all the models to be executed together, you can click on all and you can execute it. Right, now all the models have been generated, and see, the very first time I executed the model, time was something 3.09 seconds. Okay, the second time I have executed the model, it is 1.99 second, because whenever we are working with machine learning, the 70-30 partition is done in a random way. Seed is different. Obviously, the 70% part, 70-30 partition is different. Okay, so the partitions has been created in a random way. All right. When we select the model, we execute it. We'll get the results. We can show the results with the help of evaluate. Now I will just explain one result, that is in case of decision tree model. See, we discussed about actual and predicted yesterday. Now the actual value is 1 and the model gave the output as correct. It gave the output as 1. Predicted value is 1 for 20.4% cases. Okay. Now when the actual value was 1 and your model gave the incorrect output 2, that is 0. And same is the case with 3 also. Okay. So this is the confusion matrix. So in case of decision tree, your overall error is 12.9%. Right. In case of random forest, your overall error is just 1.9%. In case of SVM, your overall error is 0%. So which model is better? SVM. Okay. If you go with the error, which model is better? SVM. That is how you will execute the inbuilt models. Okay. And you can download the data from UCI repository and you can try with cluster and association problems for unsupervised learning. Right?
Yeah, I think Shweta, you are clear. Still, if you have any doubt, you please first execute in your system. So still you face any query, then you may ask tomorrow. Okay. So there is one question. There is one question from Asif that why R and MOS report different P values but same estimates. So Mr. Asif, actually what happens that as you know that MOS is a powerful structure equation modeling software which helps support your research and theories by extending standard multivariate. But actually, if one of the software uses bootstrapped standard error and the other not, so this may also lead to a difference between p-values. So you please check if this is the case or not. Secondly, most analysis in MOS, if I talk about the particularly MOS, many times it include default models with bootstrapped estimates and errors also. Whereas that might not be the case when you get estimates of the same models in R. So I suggest you to please check if this is the case, and you will get the solution. I hope, Asif, you are clear now. And Mr. Mirza is asking, Dr. Jasminder, what are the steps of image recognition?
What are the steps of image recognition? Okay.
Yeah.
See, basically for image recognition, or you can say the detection of an object, the steps are almost the same. Okay. We have to do the pre-processing part. Okay. Then we have to extract the features, right? And there are different techniques to extract the required features. Okay. And then after the extraction of the features, we can apply the machine learning models according to the data we have got. Okay. And further fine tuning of the models could also be done.
Yeah, it's fine. So again, that how can we extract the features from an image? I hope that we already discussed that there are some standard commands which are used to extract the features from an image. And once you get the features, that will be used for the classification, which is used as an input vector to the machine learning model. So then again, we will get the final prediction. So I think all the queries
have feature extraction is also, it is dimension reduction only. It is the dimension reduction process. Okay.
Yeah. Sure. So I think all the queries have been addressed. So Dr. Ivan, I think now we should conclude our session.
Sure. Thank you so much, Dr. Sanhu, for this interesting presentation and it's really nice hands-on experience you showed today. So I think that everybody will be able to install required tooling for this for tomorrow, like RStudio and the rest which you suggested, and do those configurations. So yes, I think that we answered all the questions and we're, I think, done for today. So I just want to thank you, Dr. Sanhu, and all the participants of this today's event.
Yeah. Right. Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Ivan. Thank you so much, all the participants. Thank you for your time.
Okay, great. So see you everybody tomorrow. Have a good evening and a good day.
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Van.